Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Tel Aviv seminar on computational geometry and robotics. We are happy to have with us today Mikkel Abrahamsen from the University of Copenhagen. Mikkel has worked on a variety of topics in computational geometry, and he will tell us today about online algorithms, about online sorting and translational packing of convex polygons. Mikkel, please.
Thank you for the introduction. So this research was initiated in the spring when Linda Kleist was visiting us here in Copenhagen. And here you can see that we even managed to do practical experiments with human strip packing. Okay, so the motivation for this work comes from many situations in everyday life. So for instance, when you cut out Christmas cookies, you want to use as much of the dough as possible with your cookie cutters, but also when you pack things in your drawers or cupboards, you encounter these packing problems. And also when you pack suitcases and your car for traveling, but even in many very large industries, we have a lot of important packing problems, for instance, in warehouses and in shipping and all kinds of transport. And maybe what is particularly interesting for the work I'm presenting here is in the clothing industry, where we have fabric or leather, and we need to cut it out in some particular pieces that can then be sewn together to furniture or clothing. And this is also explaining why it's important to study translational packing problems. So by that, I mean that the pieces that we cut out, they have a specific orientation that must be respected when we place them on the fabric. So you can see an example here, where these arrows, they must be horizontal. And that's because if we have fabric with some pattern, then in order for the clothing to turn out in a nice way, for instance, in this jacket here with the stripes, then it's important that we cut out the pieces in some specific orientation. So we cannot just rotate them. And even if we don't have a pattern, then the fabric has a pattern in itself, because it has these threads from the weaving, and therefore they must have some specific orientation. And over here you can see a picture from the company Mirisys that makes software that can actually find these very efficient packings of pieces, and which is used industrially. In this work, we were interested in what if you get your pieces online, one after the other, and then so you don't know what you will get in the future, then how well can you do? And we wanted to do this with convex pieces because it was already well studied for axis parallel rectangles, as I will get back to. So in the offline version of the problem, you know all your pieces already, and then you can compute a lot, and then decide some arrangement like this. And then the cost we pay, that's the amount of the strip we have used here. But here in the online setting, we get the pieces one after the other. So now we get this piece and we need to decide where to put it. We put it here. Then we get another one. And then this one. And then the cost is the same. It's the amount we have used in the end here. But then it's, of course, more difficult. In this particular case, we didn't use so much more than the offline solution over here. But the question is, how good can we do, actually? So we say that we have an online algorithm A, and that we say that it has a competitive ratio F of I, where I, that's some stream of pieces. It should hold that the cost of using our algorithm on this on any instance I is at most this function of I times the optimum, where this opt of I, that's the offline optimum. And then we are allowed to add some constant B here. So we are allowed to choose some big constant B here so that this can hold for all our instances. And the reason we allow to add this constant B, that's because often an online algorithm will do bad for some small instances, but what we care most about is instances where the optimum is also large. It doesn't matter so much how it does for some small tricky instances. And then we say that an algorithm is competitive if this function of our instances is bounded by some constant. So the big question here was if we can find an algorithm for strip packing convex polygons without rotation, which is competitive, so that it's always at most some constant away from the optimum. And we prove that that does not exist such an algorithm. And even if you restrict yourself to only tiny pieces, there's no algorithm for this. So this means that if your fabric here is 1 meter wide, then actually whatever algorithm you suggest, any online algorithm, then I can point out a stream of pieces so that those pieces can actually be packed. So we only use 2 meter of our fabric, but your solution will use 1 billion kilometers of fabric. So I think that's actually quite remarkable that it's so difficult. And when I explained this to my mom, then she said, that can't be true. I could do better than that. Okay, but we also look at some other versions of packing. So for instance, in bin packing, we have unit squares, and we need to pack in our convex pieces in these unit squares in an online fashion. And then our cost function is just how many of them we use. So for instance, in this case here, we have used 4 unit squares. So that's our cost. And then again, we prove that there's no competitive algorithm for this problem. And even when our pieces are smaller than any constant delta in diameter. And then we have a problem called perimeter packing. So here we can place our pieces anywhere in the plane. And then what we measure is if we take the bounding box of the final arrangement, and then we measure the perimeter of this bounding box. And then again, we prove that there's no competitive algorithm for this problem. And we have a problem we call square packing that comes together with a parameter delta. And in that problem, we get a stream of pieces, P1, P2, and so on. And we are guaranteed that the total area of these pieces is at most delta. And we are also guaranteed that the diameter of each of them is at most delta. So it looks like this. We have a unit square here. And then we want to know, does there exist an algorithm that can pack all such streams in an online fashion in this unit square? We prove that no such algorithm exists, whatever small value of delta we have here. So you can, even though you are asked to make some extremely sparse packing in our unit square because the area is so small and also the pieces are so small, then we can still trick any algorithm so that it, in the end, there will not be enough room for the next piece. Okay, as I said, there has been some research on this in the case of axis parallel rectangles. So this is a paper from the beginning of the 80s with online strip packing of axis parallel rectangles. And this one here is for bin packing. And then together with Lorenzo, who is also an author of this work here, we had a paper at Sausage last year where we proved that perimeter packing of axis parallel rectangles, we can get a 3.98 competitive algorithm. But if we want to minimize the area of the bounding box, then there's no algorithm for it. And then we have the square packing. Then there's this paper here. It's called an online potato sack theorem. So it says that if you get sufficiently small axis parallel rectangles, then you can always pack them in an online fashion into a unit square. And it's called an online, it's called a potato sack theorem because in this famous math book here, the Scottish book, they state this corollary that 1 kilogram of potatoes can be put into a finite sack. And that's because potatoes, they are convex bodies with a bounded diameter. And then if you have 1 kilogram of them, so that corresponds to saying that you have a bound on the volume and on the diameter of each of them. And then this corollary says that then you can choose your sack sufficiently large so that these potatoes can always fit in your sack. But that's so in this book, it corresponds to an offline algorithm because you can you know all your potatoes beforehand. And then in this paper here, they then studied an online version of that. And they prove that you can still do it if they appear online, but then rotation is needed. And in our version, we don't have rotation. So that's why even in the plane, we don't have this potato sack theorem for convex polygons when we are in the online setting. In general, if we allow rotations, then we can always take our pieces and rotate them so that a diameter of the piece becomes horizontal. And then we can just consider the piece to be the bounding box because this only dilutes the density by a factor of a half. The piece will occupy at least half of the area in this box. And then we can use these algorithms over here and get some bounds on the competitive ratio in this case for convex polygons with rotation. We also give some positive results. So for strip packing, there's a naive algorithm that just takes any new piece and then puts it as deep into our strip as possible. So for instance, these pieces here would create this pattern. And this is an n-competitive algorithm where n is the number of pieces because the optimal solution must use at least as much as the widest piece we get. And this uses at most n times that. Unfortunately, it's also that bad because for this particular instance, you could just do like this, and then you just use essentially twice the width of the widest piece. So therefore, this the solution produced by the algorithm is n half times worse than the optimum. But we give an algorithm which is O of n to the 0.59 competitive. And here you can see an arrangement that our algorithm could produce. So it partitions the strip hierarchically into these parallelograms. And that makes it possible for the algorithm to save some space for pieces that appear later, which have approximately the same slope. And therefore, we can get a higher density. Okay, then there's also the question about offline algorithms for translational packing of convex polygons. And then there's this recent paper by Alt, De Berg, and Knauer, where they gave a constant factor approximation algorithm for packing convex polygons with translation, so that we minimize the area of the bounding box. And the technique they use is that they group the pieces into height classes, and then in each height class, they sort the pieces by these dashed segments here called their spine segments. So it's the segment that connect the highest corner to the lowest corner. Then when you sort the pieces by the slope of these segments, and then arrange them on a line like this, then you get a fan-like pattern. And the pieces in such a fan, they will have constant density in this strip. And then they use this as a building block to make packings with high density. And in our paper, we show that you can do the same for strip packing and bin packing and square packing and perimeter packing. But what is perhaps more interesting is that we show that in order to get a good packing, you are actually forced to make a arrangement somewhat like this. And what makes it impossible to solve these packing problems online is exactly that you cannot maintain this sorted order when you get your pieces one by one. So the tool we use is a new problem we introduced that we call online sorting. The problem comes with a parameter gamma and then in, and the gamma is some value at least one. And in that problem, we have an array of size gamma times n. And then we have a zero, a sentinel value zero out here and a sentinel value one out here. And then one by one, we get a number in the unit interval and we need to put this in our array. So here we get 0.7 and we put it here. And here 0.2, and then maybe we get some zeros here. Then when we are done, then we consider our numbers in order from left to right in our array. And then the cost is just the sum of differences of consecutive numbers in our array. So that means that the optimal solution is to put the numbers in sorted order and then we get a cost of one. And our results on this problem is that if we have a delta competitive algorithm for the problem with gamma times n space, then we have a lower bound on delta times gamma of omega of log n over log log n. So that's a super constant lower bound on this product here. And then we consider the special case where we have exactly enough space. So we have exactly n space available. And then we prove that all algorithms will have a lower bound of square root n for that in that case. But we also give an algorithm that has that matches that asymptotically. And then we consider the case where we have a little bit extra space. So we have 1 plus epsilon times n space. And then we have an algorithm with competitive ratio 2 to the big O of square root log n log log n. So it's a sub polynomial, but it's anyway far from matching what we get from this lower bound up here. And then we make these reductions. So we have our online sorting problem here, and then we reduce that to strip packing. And then we reduce strip packing to strip packing with bounded diameter, bin packing with bounded diameter, and square packing. And then we can finally reduce square packing to perimeter packing. And I would like to, if time permits, I would like to tell you about this reduction and also this reduction here. So the first reduction, which is the most interesting one, I think, from online sorting to strip packing. So then we assume that we have a C competitive algorithm for strip packing, and then we will give a 4C competitive algorithm for online sorting with 2C n space. So we have our strip here, and we look at the first part of it of length 2C, and then we have our array here, which then has length 2C n. And then I will tell you how to get an algorithm for online sorting if we have an algorithm for strip packing. So we get some real number in the unit interval, and then we construct a piece that looks like this. So it's a parallelogram of height exactly one, and the horizontal segments here have length one over n. And then the width of the non-horizontal segments is the number r that we got. Then we ask our strip packing algorithm, where should this go? And it places it here. And then we look at the x coordinate of the lower left corner. And then we take that value and multiply by n and round down. And that's then the entry in our array where we will put it. So when we have drawn our array and the strip like this on top of each other, then it's just the same as like projecting down vertically. Here's another one, and we put that number here. And this will not cause any collisions because our parallelograms, they have these horizontal segments have length 1 over n. So when we multiply by n, we get 1. So therefore, the difference will be at least 1. So we can never get two that are going to the same cell. Then when we are done, then we remember that we consider our numbers in left to right order. So that's these sets down here. And then the cost of our packing, we denote that by cost P. It's this one. And then let's look at what does the optimal solution for packing look here. So that's actually just the one we get by sorting the pieces like this. And then the base segments here, they will take up a length of one of the strip. And then the extra space here, that's the width of this segment of the last piece, and that's at most one. So therefore the optimal packing has size at most two. And since we assume the packing algorithm to be C competitive, that means that actually our packing algorithm, it will use at most this 2C of the strip that we consider. So therefore it will always place the pieces in here, and therefore we can always make the translation that I explained to you. So let's now look at why we get this 4C competitive algorithm out of it. We already saw we have this inequality that the cost of the packing is at most 2C, but now I claim that if we take the cost of our online sorting solution, it's this one, and then if we take half of that, then it's at most the cost of the packing. So to prove it, this we will find, we will point out the terms in this sum up here in the packing. So we have some terms here where the second number is the smallest one. So for instance, from this number here to this one here, we go down, and that corresponds to we have a piece here that is that has a lot of slope, and then one here that is more steep. And then the distance here between the two base segments, that will be at least the difference between these two numbers here, because because of the way we define these pieces, and the same over here. So therefore, this difference between these two numbers, that's at least this difference, and likewise over here. And then if it's the other way around, that the second number is the largest, as from this one to this one, then we will have at least that difference on top, because our pieces get more steep. So this explains that where we can find all terms in this sum geometrically up here, except for the first and the last terms in the sum. So the first one here from C0 to C1, that difference will be at most this distance from the beginning of the strip to the top segment of the first piece. And then we have the last difference here. This difference here is of course at most one, because our numbers are in the unit interval, but then we can just find it as the sum of the lengths of these base segments up here. So now we have found all terms in this sum up in our strip. And then at least half of these distances that we have pointed out, they must appear along the top edge of our strip or along the bottom edge of our strip. So therefore half of this sum is at most the cost of our packing. And then multiplying by two, we get that The cost of our online sorting is at most 4C. So therefore, our online sorting algorithm that we have defined like this, it's 4C competitive, and it uses 2C times n space. So that's the connection between these two problems here. Okay, then I would like to show you the lower bound of omega of square root n for online sorting in the special case where we have exactly enough space for our n numbers. So I use this example with n equal to 8 to illustrate the how the lower bound works. So we will make an adversary that play numbers from this set, so k over square root 2n, where k can then go from 0 up to square root 2n. So in this case with n equal to 8, then this will be exactly the number 0, a quarter, a half, 3/4, and 1. Then we say that if we take one of these numbers here, then it's expensive if it doesn't appear anywhere in our array such that there's an empty space next to it. And then the intuition why we say it's expensive, that is because if we then force this to be placed in our array, then it will be placed next to something that's different from it, and then it will raise the cost of our solution. Then we make an adversary player that whenever there is an expensive number R, then it will present this number to be put in our array. And if at some point there's no expensive number, so that means that all the numbers in this set here, they have empty cells next to them, then we will play just zero until the array is full. So then we have two cases. Either we never get to this step two in the adversary algorithm. That means that we can keep on playing expensive symbols, but that means that in the end, all neighbors are different in the produced solution. Because if we had two that were the same, then the second of them would have been placed when that one was not expensive. So that means that whenever we go from a cell to the next, then we make a cost of 1 over square root 2n, and we do this n plus 1 times, and that's then omega of square root n. The other case is that we get to this step 2. So that means that at some point we have all our values represented in the array, and they all have empty cells next to them, and then our adversary plays zero for or until the array is full. And then if we look at one particular value here, k over square root 2n, then when we get zeros on both sides of it, then it will add at least cost k over 2 square root 2n. And therefore, when we sum over all our values, then we will get the sum of that for k equal to 0 up to square root 2n. So that's then equal to omega of the square root of the last number. It's just a sum formula. So we have omega of n divided by square root 2n, and therefore it's omega of square root n all in all. Okay, then we also have a matching algorithm that makes, in this case where we have exactly n space, and we get a competitive ratio of at most 18 square root n. And I should say that this proof is by Shyam Narayana, who is a colleague of my co-author Anas at MIT now. So in our original version, we had an extra factor of log n here that he managed to get rid of. So what we do is that we we partition the unit interval into intervals of length 1 over square root n, like this. And then we take our array here, and then we divide that into the double number of, so we divide that into 2 square root n blocks. I can see I'm there should be some segments over here also to make it. All the blocks here should have the same length. And then when we get some value from one of these intervals, then we assign it to one of these blocks of cells, and then we will just put them in there from left to right. So if we get one here first, then we will put it in here, and then we will say that in this one, we will only put values from that interval. And then maybe we got one from here next time, and so on. And then at some point, this one will maybe be full. Now we have filled it up with values from this interval. Then we need a new place to put values from this interval. Then we will assign this one because it was not already used for something else. Then in the end, we will have a situation where we have filled up some blocks and some are not filled up yet, but we have one here that has filled up 3 blocks here, and now there's not room for more of more values from this interval because all the others are already assigned to other intervals. So the others, they are partially filled like this. And then what we do is that we take all the remaining space here. So this one was not used yet, and these here are not used. And then we consider them as just one array. And that will have, since we have the double number of blocks here as we have intervals up here, then at least half of our intervals must be completely full. And therefore, the cells here that we have not used, that's at most n over 2 that we have left. And then we can use induction, and we can fill recursively this non-used part. So then we will just behave as if there was not these jumps between the unfilled versions, and then use the same algorithm again. And then inductively, we can assume that we get a cost of at most 18 times square root n halves, because we have at most n half cells. And then the total cost will be this. So this term here, n over square root n, that's for all pairs in all pairs of consecutive numbers in these red blocks. And then 2 square root n, that's whenever we jump from one block to the next one. So since we have 2 square root n blocks, then we and each of these jumps is at most 1, then we get this 2 square root n. And then we have a square root n here. That's whenever we jump from a red one to one that we fill recursively. That happens at most square root n times. And then we have the value here that we had a bound inductively. And then when you evaluate this, you get this bound of at most 18 times square root n. Okay. So we had this reduction that said that if we have a C competitive algorithm for strip packing, then we have a 4C competitive algorithm for online sorting with 2C in space. So, and then we have this general lower bound that I've not shown you. That's much more technical than the previous things. But that means that when we have a 4C competitive algorithm for online sorting with 2C times n, and then we know that 4C times 2C, so the competitive algorithm times the space, that's at least omega of log n over log n by our general lower bound. And then it implies that then C must be omega of the square root of log n over log n. And now I will show you how we then do. So this is a general lower bound for strip packing. And now I will show you how we get a lower bound even for strip packing with small pieces. Then we take, suppose that we have an algorithm for strip packing small pieces of diameter at most delta. Then we partition that into vertical substrips of width at most delta over four. And then we can take those substrips and put them out here horizontally. And then we get one long thin strip of height delta over four. And then we will use our lower bound in this thin strip here to get a lower bound up here. So what we do is that when we get a piece to pack in this thin strip, then we take the piece and make it doubled as high. And then we rotate it. And then we ask our algorithm here for strip packing small pieces where it should be put. And then because we doubled the height, then it will cross both vertical edges of one of these substrips. And then this placement here corresponds to this placement here because it's in the third substrip. And it's placed like this, and then we have a correspondence between this strip and this strip, like that. And then we know that we can force this algorithm here to make a competitive ratio of at least square root log n over log log n, and that will then correspond to this algorithm here for small pieces to also use so much, because this this delta over four here, that's just a constant factor that will, so the packing will be a constant factor better, but not more than that. So therefore this lower bound carries over. Okay, then we have an algorithm also for strip packing that's better than the naive algorithm. I can explain the idea how the algorithm works in the special case where we give it just parallelograms that have height one and width at most one. What we do is that we introduce this box type tree. So that's some special boxes where we will put pieces. So each box can contain one piece like this, or it can contain two smaller boxes like this. And we get these boxes by our basic box here has size 2 times 1. And then we partition the edges into thirds and connect them like this. Then we get three children here that are sloped more in the different directions, and then we can repeat this process so we get an infinite tree of a ternary tree of these box types. Then when we get a piece, we will find the smallest type of box in this box type tree, and then we want to pack the piece in that box. And and if there's nowhere to place it already, then we need to allocate new space. So for instance, this piece here, it can only fit in our basic box type up here. So therefore we allocate a basic box here in our strip and then put the piece here. And now we will not put anything more in that box because it is occupied by a piece. So now we got this piece here, and I think a piece of this type here will be the suitable for this. Then we need to allocate a basic box, and then in that we will allocate the box that's suitable for that piece. That means that now we have actually room here to allocate one more box of one of these types here. Now we get this piece. So this one cannot be put in here because it has to be put in a piece of this type. So therefore we need to allocate a new basic box where we can then put a box of this and then put the piece into that. But now we got this one. I think it fits maybe in this type here or something like that. So therefore we can allocate a piece of a box of this type here, and then a box that fits your piece here. And then the algorithm keeps on doing like this. And then this algorithm is big O of n to the 0.59 competitive. And now I will explain to you where this number comes from. When this algorithm works, it will make some near empty boxes. So that's boxes where we have put in one box, but not two. So for instance, this blue basic box here is near empty. And then this one here is also near empty. We could put in one more box here and one more box here. So let's look at the situation if we have no near empty boxes. And then let's look at a packing in just one basic box. And let's see why then we get a density of at least omega of n to the 1 minus log 3. So that's then the inverse of this. So if we have a density of at least this, then we get a competitive ratio of at most this. Because you cannot do better than filling out everything. So if we have no near empty boxes, then we can represent what we have packed into one basic box by a binary tree, where each node has either two children, so that would be two boxes allocating in it, or it has none. And if it has none, then it's because it contains a piece. So then it will look like this. Then we make a replacement argument where we make the tree full instead of like here, where it's different how many ancestors a node has. And by doing this, we can observe that the density actually decreases. So whenever we go a step down in the tree here, we lose a factor of 2/3 in the density, because we allocate two boxes into one box. So there will be 1/3 of the space that's wasted. And then if we take two leaves down here and then remove them, and then instead put two new boxes in this piece, then we will actually lose more space up here than we gain down here. Because here we have put a big piece in a box. So there we have a high density, but here we have here the pieces are very small. So if we remove them, then we don't, this doesn't dilute the density so much, but this will dilute, putting new pieces in this box instead will dilute the density much more, because the pieces up here are larger. So by proving that the worst case is actually if all our pieces are at the same distance from the root, then we can use that as a lower bound for the density. And if we do that, then we have, then the height of our tree will be logarithmic. And that means that the total area here, so we have n pieces at most, and each of them, every time we go one level down in the tree, then the size of our pieces is decreased by a factor of 3. So therefore the pieces down here, they have size 3 to the minus log n, and we have n of them, and therefore the total area of them will be omega of n to the 1 minus log 3. Then we have that density, and that leads into this competitive ratio. And this was in the case that we had no near empty boxes, and then we actually just need to show that we, in general, we have few near empty boxes. And the good thing about this pack, this algorithm, is that there can be at most two near empty boxes of each type, because if we have this one if we have allocated this box in a basic box and this box in a basic box, then whatever new box we need to allocate, it can fit either here or here. So if we get one more of this type, then it can be placed here. If we get one more of this type, it can be placed here. And if we get one that's vertical, then it can be placed either place. So there can be at most two of each type that are near empty. And then we can consider our box type tree and count how many near empty boxes we can have. And the idea is that if we have a near empty box, then we will consider an alternative situation where we have filled it out with a piece. So if we have this one and it's near empty, then we can say that now we put in a piece here. And then we just need to show that we don't need to put pieces of a large area to fill out all our near empty boxes. So we prove that if we fill in big O of log n area, then actually we will have filled out all our near empty boxes, and then it will dilute the density by at most a factor of log n. So then we get that the density is n to 1 minus log 3 divided by log n. So what we do is that we consider the maximum level in our box type tree, where we have 2 to the L near empty boxes. And that means that because there is a piece in each of these near empty boxes, then we must have that this L is at most log n. And then we group our layers into two categories. That there are the ones from the root down to level L. And here we need to, the pieces we need to add, they have size in level I, the pieces have size 3 to the minus I, and there are 3 to the I of them because it's a ternary tree. So in each level we add pieces of a constant area. And therefore, because L is at most log n, then this adds at most log n area in, at most. And then all the other layers. We know that because we chose L like this, then when we take a level below that, then there are at most 2 to the I pieces in a layer I down here. And each piece has size 3 to the minus I. And then we get this geometric sum. So therefore, all in all, for all these layers down here, we add at most a constant area to our packing. Yeah, and that then proves that we get this density, and therefore we get the competitive ratio. Okay, so a summary here for strip packing. We have proven a lower bound of square root log n over log n and an upper bound of big O of n to the 0.59. And big bin packing, we also have the same lower bound. Perimeter packing, there we get a fourth root of log n over log n. And for square root, for square packing, we show that for any delta larger than zero, there exists a stream of area at most square root log n over log n. So note that this is decreasing in n. So there's a subconstant bound on how much we can pack into our unit square. And then for online sorting, we have the general lower bound of if we take the competitive ratio times the extra space, then it must be at least omega of log n over log n. And for online sorting with exactly the same space, we have upper and lower bounds of square root n. And for online sorting with 1 plus epsilon times n space, we have this upper bound here, which is very far from the lower bound we have here, but it was the best we could do. Okay, that was all I wanted to say.
Thank you very much, Mikkel. You can express your thanks in the Zoom fashion. Questions?
Yeah, I have a question. So just to be sure, when you do your packing, strip packing, you can take the polygon and put it you don't need to translate it. You just put it where you want to do. I mean, when you want to put it. I mean, it just, you don't need, like, if something blocks it from getting to the position, it doesn't, you just put it from, you just raise it and put it there, yeah?
Yes. Yeah, you don't have to navigate it through the other pieces.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because I have a paper from 25 years ago on when you need to navigate it, when you need to move it. And then we show that even if you have rectangles, then you have, then the competitive ratio is not constant. You have a lower bound of, a non-constant lower bound. Of course, this is harder in some sense.
Yeah. Actually, I have a master's student who just wrote a project among about this paper and some subsequent work by Sandor Fekete and his co-authors. So I'm also aware of this work of yours.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Another question? Let me ask you, Mikkel. Suppose instead of a strip, you have a quadrant, and say at the end of the packing, you put a line parallel to the line y equal minus x or something like this. Is the quadrant problem easier or harder, or is there an obvious connection between them?
So you wanted to minimize the rectangle that also has the origin as a corner?
Yeah.
I would think that, so it, was it like minimizing the perimeter of this?
No, I would say like here you count the farthest point from the origin. I would count the farthest point in the direction of y equals x.
The point that is farthest from the diagonal of the quadrant?
Yes. Okay, just food for thought.
But if you just want them to be close to the diagonal, then you can just keep placing your pieces exactly on the diagonal, I guess.
No, I didn't explain myself. I have a lead that is orthogonal to the line y equals x. And when you finish packing, I push this lead as far towards the origin as possible. And then I count the area that is there.
I think when it's, if you want to minimize area in this problem, I think it's already not possible for axis parallel rectangles.
Okay.
And then I think if you want to like take the perimeter instead, then I think you can do something similar to this lower bound here for perimeter packing. That would be my guess.